This video is going to be about pseudo-random number generation on a computer. It turns out that computers are not random, even though they are designed to look like they're producing random numbers. So we're going to introduce the idea of a seed on a computer, which is going to help us see and believe that computers are in fact deterministic. They are pre-planned in some sense, that a sequence of random number generation, randomly generated numbers, is reproducible, which turns out to have a lot of benefits for modern day science. But for now, we're just going to get the understanding that computers aren't random. They're instead programmed to look like they're random. After we get this understanding, we're going to revisit the Bernoulli and binomial distributions from week 5. A lot of students had problems explaining the Bernoulli and binomial random numbers they generated because it looks like every time you call our binome that you get new random numbers out of the function. And that created difficulties for us when we went to knit our course notes. So after getting an understanding that computers are not in fact random, and we'll figure out how to control the randomness, we'll revisit these examples such that I hope you all will go back to your examples of Bernoulli and binomial random variables in week 5 and maybe add a little bit more detail to those examples with the help you gain from this video. So here we go into R. I'm just going to use the function rbinom for randomly generate binomial random variables. I'm going to say let's just generate 5, where there is number of trials equals to 1. So that's actually just going to make for me 5 Bernoulli random variables. And just because I can, I'm going to pick a biased coin with a probability of 1 equal to 0.2. And if we generate, if we hit enter, we get out 5 numbers, each one of which can be 1 or 0, depending on the probability of observing a 1, that 20%. And if you run that line of code again, you might get different numbers. Look, with a 1/5% chance of observing a 1 in 5 draws, we're going to probably observe at least 1, 1, and mostly zeros. But the point here is it looks like this sequence of random numbers is unique every time I call the function. And in fact, it's not. What R is doing is picking what's called a seed for you. And then based off this seed, it is following a predetermined sequence of numbers. The best way I can show that to you is through the function set.seed. And then if you specify some positive integer in there, and then call rbinom, you're going to get what looks like a new random sequence of Bernoulli observations. But watch this. If you just set that seed again and call that same function after setting the seed, you will get the exact same sequence of numbers, no matter how many times you iterate this pattern. By setting the seed, you are establishing the random numbers that will be generated after it. So we can, you can pick any seed you want, any positive integer you want, really. I'm just going to try to show you with the seed I chose, 1, 2, 3, because I'm not very clever. So here are 55, hopefully, Bernoulli random variables with a probability of 1 of 0.2. And I'm going to store that into x. And I can show you what x looks like if you want. Then I'm going to set the seed again. And I'm going to generate this one into y. And then I'm going to show you that x and y are all equal. In fact, every value in x and y are identical. What the point of me increasing the sample size here is to show you that however many numbers you generate after calling set.seed, that entire sequence is predetermined based on the seed you pick, no matter how many numbers you generate. Now, if you call our binom again, without setting the seed again, you will get a new sequence of numbers. Such that there is a difference between X and Z because we did not set the seed before calling this line of code. So we can force a computer to reproduce the exact same numbers it did last time. And you all should get these same sequences on your machines if you use the same seed that I did. Now let me show you the issue a lot of students encountered in week 5's material when they tried to generate some random Bernoulli or binomial observations and then describe them in the course notes. So here we are in our course notes. And down here in week 5, maybe you had a definition for the Bernoulli distribution, and maybe you had an example going. And what you might have done is something like this. I'm going to generate 3 Bernoulli observations from a fair coin. And maybe you clicked on this one here to say, run the current chunk, and let's just see what we get. And so you said to yourself, okay, I know how to interpret these numbers. Let's just try one more example. Yep, I know how to interpret these numbers. Let's go ahead and knit. And then I'll write a sentence based on the numbers I get in my course notes. Except you see, this time we didn't get the same numbers that we got when we tried it by just running the current chunk. As soon as you hit knit, our binom was called again, and the output of that next iteration showed up in your course notes. So the trick here is to set the seed just before you call our binom. So I'm just going to pick another random seed. It doesn't matter which. I'm going to run the current chunk here. This random seed generates for us the sequence 110, which I hope you can still interpret. And when we click knit, because we're setting the seed, in our course notes, even though it calls our binom again, it will set the seed first, such that we get that same sequence of numbers. So now when you go into your course notes and you explain the output of our binom, that output will be consistently 110 as long as your seed is 234. If you copy this code exactly, you should see exactly this sequence, which makes this line of code reproducible across our different machines. Now, I only want you to set the seed if you are attempting to enable this reproducibility idea. But if you're doing something like simulating the sampling distribution of the sample mean, then there's no real need to set the seed ahead of time. Only if you're trying to ensure that you know what numbers are going to be output so that you can explain them consistently from your input document all the way over to your output document. Only when you need to explain something like this do I want you to set the seed. I will try to remember from here on out to tell you when it's appropriate to set the seed and when you should just call R whatever distribution you want. I hope that better explains to you the idea that computers are not random. They are pseudo-random. If you don't set the seed, R will choose a seed for you and generate numbers based on that. It will look as though it's random because you per se don't know the exact seed it started from. And generally, computers are sufficiently random based on the seed. But if you want to force them to be deterministic, force your computer to be not random, you can set the seed yourself just before you generate any random numbers you want. It's a fun little trick to show off, if nothing else. But for you all, it should help you revisit your examples in week 5 for the Bernoulli and binomial distributions. And if you haven't done so already, I encourage you to add examples where you interpret the outcomes of your randomly generated numbers for both Bernoulli and the binomial distribution.